Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
So nice to see all of you today. I thought, oh, Memorial Day weekend, I wonder if folks will be out on the beach. So I'm so glad you came here to worship. And it is today the seventh Sunday of Easter. Next Sunday is Pentecost Sunday, so we're almost through the Easter season. Many of you have shared joys and concerns with me during the week. You emailed me, texted me, you Facebooked me, or you filled out the clipboards at the back of the room. So thank you for sharing your prayer requests in advance. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Lord, how we're grateful to be here this morning on a beautiful sunny Sunday on a holiday weekend. God, you give us a gift when you give us extra vacation days, extra time, because we are so in need of Sabbath. We're so in need of a day of rest, and so often we do not give that to ourselves. So we thank you for the blessing of a holiday weekend and ask that you would use it to refresh and revive us. God, we're glad to be here this morning with brothers and sisters in Christ. And as we come here, God, we want to come with clean hearts. We want to come full of hope and optimism for how you've made us and also who we can be because of you. And so, God, we come and offer our confession to you. If there are things that we have done during the week that we regret, things that have grieved you or harmed others, God, we have sinned. We name those things before you in our heart now. And we ask, God, that you would help us through the power of the Spirit to do better so that we can be better witnesses of your love in this world, so that they know that we're Christians by our love, like we just sang. God, thank you for hearing our confession, and thank you for your forgiveness. Allow us to walk tall in that new life that Christ gives us.
Thank you.
Are you excited about a three-day weekend?
Yeah.
Anybody doing anything special this weekend? Yeah. You can be in the parade, yeah? That's in Welling, or Tewksbury, right?
Both.
Sure.
Okay, good.
Yes. Wait. You're doing the parade here? Yeah, our church is in the parade. See our parade banner right over there? That's going to be on the side, two of them, one on each side of Kevin Spicer's van. We're going to have a little trailer, and I hope all of you can come and hang out in the trailer and throw candy at people.
Well, I'm going to be marching with the Cub Scouts.
And you can be marching with the Cub Scouts, too. That's right. Lots of fun things this weekend. But why do we celebrate Memorial Day? Do you know?
To honor the veterans that have died.
To honor the veterans that have died. And you know what? I want you to think about it this way. Do we know of anybody else who died for the people they love, to save the people they love? When we're in church, can you think about that? Been here in church.
Pops.
Oh. That's true. But you know what I'm thinking about is Jesus. Jesus is our main example of somebody who sacrificed himself so that we could have life, right? And Jesus did that so we could have a spiritual life and live with God in heaven forever. But it sort of reminds me of our soldiers who are willing to go into battle and even to the point where they have to die protecting our country and protecting our freedom. And that's a really wonderful thing. So when we think about Memorial Day, we think about the soldiers who've gone and served, but especially those who've lost their life protecting and defending us because they are a blessing from God. Yes?
I don't think he died in it, but what if I go, when I think my mom's grandfather was in the army.
A lot of us have people who served in the military in our families, don't we? And even people in this room. So today, you have Game Sunday.
Yay!
Fun. Okay, I don't know if they're excited. Joey, thank you for your leadership. My mic is ringing. Thank you. Ellen's praying. Lord God, thank you for giving us Jesus, who gave his life so that we could have life eternally. And thank you for our soldiers who are willing to serve and even give their lives to help protect us here. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is the sermon. Okay.
They all mean school, okay.
You did the sermon twice, it's a holiday.
Okay, so David said, sent some of his guys over to Nabal and said, you know, just go and give him our greetings and, you know, just pay a friendly visit. So they did that. And of course, in that time and place, when somebody dropped by, you showed them hospitality, you invited them in, you gave them food, blah, blah, blah. Well, Nabal was in no mood to sign up for coffee hour that week. So he turned them away and sent them away. So they went back to David and told him what had happened, and he said, put on your swords, we're going to go show those guys a thing or two about hospitality. So they started out with their swords ready to go teach him a lesson. But Nabal's wife, Abigail.
No, no, let's start. Just read it.
Okay. Abigail means one smart cookie. And she took them the whole coffee hour and went out and met them in the desert with an apology and a lot of food. Okay. So we're starting at 32. It's a very small part of the story. David said to Abigail, praise be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has sent me today to meet me. May you be blessed for your good judgment and for keeping me from bloodshed this day and from avenging myself with my own hands. Otherwise, as surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, who has kept me from harming you, if you had not come quickly to meet me, not one male belonging to Nabal would have been left alive by daybreak. Then, then David accepted from her hand what she had brought him and said, go home in peace. I have heard your words and granted your request. And I will leave it to Rachel to tell you what happens next.
All right. I know. See, it was supposed to be like a teaser. You're supposed to be like, what? I don't understand. I must listen to the sermon.
Now, look, when I read it over, I said that I don't understand what happened to you.
It's a good thing you're here today.
No, I really am. So
I never get the
power. Oh my goodness, fresh.
Okay. It's why there's preaching, right? So that we can understand, we can open up the word. But thank you for being interested. I do appreciate that and for wanting to understand. I need to center myself in prayer. Let's pray. God, thank you for lively stories from scriptures that compel us to know more. God, we ask that you would be with us through the power of the Holy Spirit during these moments so that we can hear the scripture and hear what you have to say to us and apply it into our lives. Be with me and help me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. So this whole school year, we have been doing a sermon series, a 30-part sermon series on who we are becoming as Christians, because we know that as little kids learn and grow, they're becoming adults, becoming the people they're going to be. But even for us as adults, right now, the things that we do and learn and intend today, in a year or 3 years from now, are who we are becoming. So we want to be intentional as Christians and cultivate the things that allow us to become better examples of God's love in the world. So we've been going through all these 30 topics, and today is number 29. There's only one left in the series, which is sad for me because I love it. This section, this last 10-week section, we've been talking about the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, self-control, hope, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, and humility. Those are our sermon topics for 10 weeks. And today, gentleness. Gentleness is not a confusing word. You know what I mean when I say someone is gentle or not gentle. But I want to expand or make a point on the word gentleness for a moment. The first thing that pops into my mind when I think about gentleness is when you bring that baby home from the hospital, and big brother, big sister says, who's about this tall, 3 years old, says, can I hold the baby? And you're like, extend love and affection. You want that bond to be good. And so you put the 2 or 3 year old kid right there in the corner of the sofa, like right up against the corner, as far back as possible. And you put pillows over here so there's like all sorts of protection. And you take that baby and you put the baby in Big Brother's lap and you say, "Gentle, right, gentle." And Big Brother sits there like this, not even wanting to breathe because they're so afraid that they might harm the baby. Because they realize compared to this baby, they are so strong and so big, even though they're 3 years old. But they need to use their strength for good right now. They need to control themselves and be gentle. Gentleness implies strength. It implies that you are more powerful than something else. If you need to be gentle, it is because you are strong. It is because you could harm someone if you were to,
explode.
Exactly. Thank you. Gentleness does not imply weakness or meekness or being scared or conflict averse. Gentleness implies strength. You must be strong to be able to be gentle. I like that point. Isn't that a good point? We can stop there, especially since my mom already appears to But then, I scheduled out this preaching, you know, for the whole year, and then realized, oh my gosh, now I have to talk about gentleness on the same weekend that we celebrate our soldiers. And we celebrate the greatest military the world has ever seen. How do gentleness and soldiers go together? I think I got it. We can talk about gentleness on Memorial Day weekend. But first, let's back up just for a minute. We talked to the kids about Memorial Day weekend. I thought that was important to do because I want to be honest with you. I didn't really understand clearly the difference between Memorial Day and Veterans Day until I was an adult. I sort of knew it was a patriotic holiday, but I hadn't separated out. And as it turns out, when I was doing research for this sermon, one of the main themes that you see is, why don't people know the difference between Veterans Day and Memorial Day? People being exasperated about that. So we're clear that Veterans Day is about all veterans, right? And Memorial Day is about those who served who died in conflict. But we don't spend a whole lot of time talking about that. Mostly what we're talking about is what we're doing. If we're headed to the beach, we're headed to Maine, we're headed to the Cape. Calvin is down on the Cape this weekend with a friend. It's good for him. The traffic was terrible going down there. Can you not do the slides right now, please? Thank you. I'll tell you when, though. Thank you. My family is just all over the place. Help, don't hinder. Mostly people are thinking about their vacation plans. Mostly, and I was saying that the traffic going up to Maine, apparently the whole state of New Hampshire on I-95 was backed up. That's how bad it was. Everyone's thinking about getting out of town. If you're in town, like we are, maybe it's time to work on some gardening projects. I was out yesterday whacking in the bushes in the front of my house, not being gentle at all, by the way, to my bushes, working on this sermon. So you get to do things like that. And maybe during Memorial Day weekend, you go to your computer or open up your phone, you look at the email or your social media, and you start to see some memes, which are no longer a surprise. Thank you, by the way. So you might see something like that, right? Not really sure if it's Memorial Day or National Barbecue Day, because today is actually National Hamburger Day. Did you know that? It actually is. I saw that on Facebook today. Then we're sort of clear because we're more focused on stock in the fridge for the barbecue than we are about our veterans. We might see something else like this. Can you scroll down, please? Have an awesome Memorial Day weekend. That's great. Look at how the sky looks all patriotic and American. That's super. But it doesn't really tell us what the weekend's about. Maybe there's another thing you see as you look at your email. Oh, land of the free because of the brave. That's getting closer to the point of Memorial Day. What about this? I like this. Your day at the beach brought to you by their day at the beach. Good. All right, now we start to understand that it's about our service members, but this one does best of all. Please wait until I cue you, Wesley. Okay, go ahead. This one I think did best of all. I hope you can see the numbers of people who lost their lives in those different battles. And it gives us, or at least for me, an appreciation once again about the sizes of those world wars. So this helps us get at what it is. But then you may see other posts related to Memorial Day that are something like this. Can you show us the next one? Real heroes don't wear capes, they wear dog tags and combat boots. And I think, yeah, we're talking about our soldiers as heroes here. And it's not just the skull that's behind that mask that makes me uncomfortable, but all of a sudden I'm wondering about talking about heroes like this. And what the goal of a heroic action is. Okay, you can scroll down a slide. For me, it becomes a balance then, as Christians and as Americans, between honoring all those heroes who serve and who are willing to put down their life for our safety, honoring that, and not romanticizing or glorifying war itself. Right? That's a balancing act for us as we go through any patriotic holiday in the United States. We do have the greatest and strongest, most powerful military. It's awesome. We should be so proud of it. But is the highest goal war? Defeating other people with war? Or is it something else? And are there other kind of heroes that are present when we start to think about conflict? This is where the story of Abigail comes in. Abigail lived during a time that Israel was under its first king, King Saul. Some of this will be review for us this morning. Under King Saul. And Saul was a pretty good king. He was doing a great job. And so who's going to be king next? How do kings work? Oldest son, right? Obviously everyone knows. Saul knows this too. But guess what? God had different ideas. So the prophet Samuel finds out from God that David, who is unrelated to Saul, is going to be the next king of Israel. And so Samuel, while Saul is still ruling, anoints David king. This makes Saul very unhappy. He is not comfortable at all that David is around, but Samuel the prophet is holding King Saul in check. So while Samuel is alive, David and his men and his loyal soldiers around him, because he's a military man, while Samuel is alive, David's doing okay. But then Samuel dies. And now David's got to watch out. So he runs out into the wilderness, he and the soldiers around him who are loyal to him, and they're hiding out, and they're waiting for Saul's reign to end so that David can now become the king of Israel. So they're out there in the wilderness, and they happen to be nearby a bunch of sheep and shepherds for quite a while. Now, they brought a bunch of provisions out with them. They have enough supplies, but you might think David is a smart guy to plant them, you know, set up camp right next to a free lamb kebab. You know, they should need it. That would sort of make sense that he and the soldiers could benefit from that. But instead of David taking advantage of that situation and picking off some of the sheep for his soldiers and maybe bringing the shepherds to some harm, instead of doing that, David is a man of honor, and he protects the sheep and the shepherds, not only from his men, but also from any other people who would be coming by, thieves or robbers or anything. So David is acting as a protector to the sheep and the shepherds that are there. Saul takes a while to die, and they start to run out of food. So David says, well, I'm going to send 10 of my guys up to the owner of all these sheep and the master of these shepherds. I'm going to send 10 of my guys up there with a message, and I'm going to say, hey, you know, we've been nearby and we've been protecting, offering protection to your sheep and your shepherds, and we're pleased to do that for you. And we wonder if you would return the blessing to us by giving us some provisions because we're running out of food. So the guys go up and they say that. They say this to Nabal, the man who owns the land. And you know what Nabal says? Instead of thank you very much and here's something to eat, he says, David. Who's ever heard of David? I never heard of David, son of Jesse. I don't even know what that means. I don't know who this guy is. I don't owe him anything. And he gets angry, and he storms off, and he goes and plans a big dinner with all sorts of lamb and wine and all sorts of things with his friends. Just leaves. Absolutely not. I'm not doing it. So the 10 men go back to David, and they say, this is what he said. And now David's the one to get irritated. David's like, I'm kind of part of me, like, I am the next king of Israel. I have been kind to him. I have offered his shepherds protection. Now I'm asking for a little bit of repayment. He can't even do this. I'm going to be king. Are you kidding me? He said, strap on your swords, all of you, and we are going up there. And by this time tomorrow, not one man in that household will be alive. He's furious. And so they take off in force, he and his soldiers. But there was a shepherd who had been out in the fields observing how David and the soldiers had been good and kind and protective to them, who was also at the house when Nabal said, absolutely not. He overheard the whole thing. And the shepherd said, that's not right. We don't need to respond to him like this. Nabal's being a fool, like his name says, his name means. Now, the shepherd doesn't have much authority. He doesn't have much power or much control. He's the servant of Nabal. And so, and Nabal obviously is an arrogant, sort of hot-headed guy. He's not going to go to Nabal and be like, bad decision, sir. He says, what can I do? Who can I speak to? And so the shepherd goes to Nabal's wife, Abigail. Smart cookie. I like that. if we ever had another girl, Abigail. Because of this. He goes to Abigail and he says, look, this is what's going on. This is what I see. I don't think that this we responded the right way. And Abigail says, you're absolutely right. Don't even bother with her husband who's over there eating and drinking. She loads up donkey after donkey after donkey with meat and raisins and dates and water and all this really posh stuff for that time. Gets on a donkey herself and heads straight for David and his troops who are there with swords out. When she sees them, she bows low to the ground to show that she's coming in peace. And she says to David, I'm so sorry that he never should have responded to you. We appreciate you. Here are some provisions for your troop. Don't worry about Nabal at all. Just disregard him. I know that you're going to be king of Israel, and I hope you'll remember that I support you. And then she says the most brilliant thing, which is, I want you to be a great king, David. I want, when you get on that throne, I want you to be a wonderful leader. And I want your mind to be focused on the tasks at hand. I do not want you to have the guilt or the horror of bloodshed in your memory. I want to spare you from having to be in combat that way. He talked to a veteran who's seen action. Maybe talk to somebody who's come back from war. You know how much that scars people, how their lives are changed, how many vets have PTSD, how vets commit suicide at a rate of 22 a day in our country. It harms people to be in conflict, not just because you die, but because of what it does to you mentally or spiritually. She said, I don't want that for you. And David says, in the scripture that we had, thank you. Thank you for looking for a way to make peace. Thank you for sparing me that injury and conflict and that burden that I will carry. Abigail has shown David gentleness here because she sees how that strength can be held back and not used for harm. She's shown him how to be gentle. And that was wise and it was brave. There's no way that was an act of cowardice or evasion just because we all, you know, need peace at any cost. It was wisdom to show that kind of gentleness. So, when it comes to us, Memorial Day soldiers, gentleness coming from strength. This is probably my favorite meme. Thank you, Sam, for turning the lights. That our vets, our people who lost their life in service, did it so that peace would be possible, that we do not glorify war and conflict, but we see it as a means to an end for peace. So that we can practice gentleness with this amazingly huge, powerful military that we have, that the goal would not be to send them out to fight. Of course they're going to have to. This is the real world. Cooler heads do not prevail all the time. Absolutely they're going to do it, and we thank them for that. But the objective is strength, gentleness, and peace. Amen. So, once a month for this year, we've been having someone come and share their testimony, a time that God was real in their life in a way that they absolutely could not ignore. And this month, Rob Wilkinson has said that he would share with us his testimony. So let me turn the mic over to him.
My eyes. Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity. It's an interesting life I've had, 60 years, and this church has done a lot for me. And I'd like to talk about that. I'd like to talk a little bit about my past and then where we are. God, religion, faith, and belief are very confusing theories, especially when they directly contradict one's own life's experiences. Throughout my life, I've experienced these contradictions, which for most of my life, I've been a doubting Thomas. So I'd like to share a couple of those experiences with you and how my faith changed. In third grade, sorry, it's not going to be a long speech, but in third grade, while my parents' relationship was eroding, they felt I needed control. They sent me to a Lutheran day school in Wollaston. It was a very odd school in that both the third and the fifth grades shared the same classroom and teacher. It's sort of like a one-room school does. Each day after school, my care fell to a 17-year-old molester who lived in the flat above us. This went on for a good year. Thus, when I was at school, I acted out as a form of getting attention, and I soon learned that Lutherans are really, really strict. The immediate discipline, and this is no lie, the immediate discipline was taping my mouth closed with masking tape, so I couldn't talk or disturb the classroom. It was very unpleasant. And I would persist in my bad behavior, tape or not. They would send me down to the principal's office. The routine, and in front of the principal's office, I had to kneel with the tape in front of a little tiny altar. And it seemed like hours that I was there, though I'm sure it wasn't hours. I just felt that way. This routine was broken up every Wednesday when the entire school of faithfully would go down to the adjacent chapel and pray and sing. As a young child, this contradiction and the seeds of religious doubts were sown. Pain and pray for forgiveness. From ages 8 to 12, my parents separated, so my mother would take the two of us to church, any church, then off to the next church, and we would stay there at that church, we would attend it, until a sermon just hit my mother the wrong way. But then we'd be off to the next church, and so on, and the cycle continued. So I didn't have a lot of strength, religious strength there. When I was 12, my mom remarried. My new stepdad read the Bible daily. He was a proud Republican, an Episcopalian, with strong conservative conviction and an ignorant bigot. He was not unlike Archie Bunker in real life. He was completely opposite of my own father, who at the time was a member of the Old South Methodist Church in Boston. That was an unusual experience at 12, seeing men kissing and holding hands for the first time that I had ever experienced. Old South, back in the 60s, was very progressive and was heavily involved with the LGBT community. And it still is today. So I had two fathers, two opposite examples of how to have a relationship with God. That sort of sets the stage for things. Through my teen years, every girl I ever dated was Catholic. And no surprise, I eventually married a large Catholic girl in a large Catholic Irish family. I became what I would call a temporary Catholic. I never converted, thus I could never receive communion, even at my own first wedding. Sure, I could sneak up to receive communion some Sunday, but somebody would always know that you're not supposed to be in the line. Now I know what they meant by Catholic guilt. The Protestant experience in my childhood was indeed inbred. Thus, whenever I was in a Catholic church, I felt as an outsider. in the church, in the house of God. That all changed here at Aldersgate. It is here that I discovered faith, belief, and the wonderment of knowing Jesus and God. Starting with my first communion here, it had been nearly 30 years of Catholic guilt up until that moment. Frankly, I cried after being served the sacrament. It was a lightning bolt that hit me, and it became a major turning point in my spiritual life. And those who doubt the possibility of that, I'd like you to keep in mind the secular definition of communion, which is the sharing or exchanging of intimate thoughts and feelings, especially when the exchange is on a mental or spiritual level. It was at that moment, that communion, that began a continued enlightenment. Today, I grow with God, and I feel blessed that I have chosen Him to be my life. It is this church that I've learned forgiveness. It is this church that I've learned the meaning of faith. And it is with my wife, Jill, that I've seen the results of belief. Although I admit I don't read the Bible often enough, I do have daily conversations with God. I wouldn't call them prayer, more conversations. First, I like to express thankfulness, then forgiveness, and ask for direction and a path. I think it is especially important to have thankfulness. How can we not see the beauty of a sunset, the sighting of a cardinal, last of grandchildren, and experience the occasional, much larger miracle moment? I've had many miracle moments in my life, and I would like to share two with you before I go. The first one was the kidney stone. Now, how can that be a miracle moment? Well, as it turned out, the kidney stone was too big to pass. It was too hard to be broken up by ultrasound, so they made a decision to go in and get it. Well, that, when they went in to get it, they discovered that I had bladder cancer. They were able to remove that cancer, and I have been cancer-free since. And I have to tell you, that is a miracle. And it's one that I appreciate wholeheartedly. The second one was about 6 years back when my father died. This is a miracle. Following his memorial, we came home. I was settled in my memories. We went out to the backyard with the sky, and in the sky was a huge double rainbow. First one I had ever seen. There were cardinals in the bushes around us. It was just an amazing sight. It was beautiful. And I took it as a sign that God was watching over us and showed us the glory of my Father being with Him. The beauty of the two rainbows was absolutely breathtaking. And it was a major moment. And I have to thank this church. This church has done so much for me. I've learned so many things. I've come to a totally different place. And every day, I appreciate life that I have. I appreciate this church and its success. Thank you.
Lord God, thank you for speaking to us in so many ways, through the scripture, through song, through prayer, and through sacrament. God, please receive this offering from us as our way of saying thank you to what you do in our lives. Please bless it and multiply it to your service in this world. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. While he's coming up, the sign-up sheets for next week are almost empty. That means there's plenty of opportunities. So please sign up for liturgist, greeter, coffee hour, and things like that. Also, while he's getting ready for the Memorial Day parade tomorrow, we're going to meet out on the town common at 9:45. The parade starts at 10. Kids, if you want to throw candy, you got to bring candy, so bring it along with you. Also, if you want to make a poster for the trailer, you can. We'll tape it to it. It could be about God, saying God bless you, or an American flag, or whatever you want. There's opportunity for that. If you ordered a t-shirt or an apron, they have arrived. They're on the table out in the foyer. Please pay me or Sam for that and pick up your t-shirt or apron. Wear them proudly during the parade. And after the parade, immediately following, everybody's welcome to come over to our house for barbecue. Bring something to share. That's rain or shine. So even if the parade is absolutely rained out, we're still having a barbecue, so please come over, and if you want to give us a heads up that you're coming, that's helpful, so we have some idea how many people will be there. All right, John.
Okay. Hey there.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
And you're okay? All right. So a week from today, there's going to be a few of us that are going to be going down to Gillette Stadium and get shaved. And I'd like to kind of bring the team up here. Sam? Who could be the nicest looking bald guy? George?
He is already the nicest looking bald guy.
Was that a comment on his hairline?
Yeah.
And Eli.
Come on, do it.
Now, this is kind of special because. I mean, I remember Eli when he was about that tall, playing soccer in Little League, and now he's much taller and has a beard. So next week we are going down to Gillette Stadium to get our heads shaved and beards trimmed, to support kids with pediatric cancer. And I think all of us have kind of experienced what cancer can do to people. You know what. What happened to you and the amount of care that they had to be given. If you can imagine that as a parent and having to go through that with someone who might be like 4 years old or something like that, it's tough. And what this organization does, the One Mission, is that while they don't raise money to support a cure for cancer, what they do is that they help parents go through that tragedy with their kids by decorating their rooms, kind of movie nights, pizza nights, things like that to help keep the kids' spirits up. So if you haven't had a chance to donate yet, you can go online and donate. If you could put our link on, say, your Facebook page or tweet it out, get more people aware of it, that's great. We have until the end of the month for donations, but you don't have to wait that long. Oh, the end of June. I was thinking we were in June. Thank you. So, end of June, not end of May. Thank you.
No, it's Tuesday.
So,
no. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for him.
Let's give him a hand for their efforts. The link to giving is in the church email if you would like to give. Also related to cancer, the Relay for Life is this Friday at the North Reading High School track. Our church will have an outreach tent there. We provide a space for people to come, write letters to loved ones that have been affected by cancer. There's also a kneeler and some candles there if people want a quiet moment. It's a very spiritual event, even though it's secular. So we like to provide that space for people. Between 6 and 10 p.m., we need people to hang out at the tent because there are live flames off the candles there. Please talk to me if you are able to help out on Friday night, anytime between 6 and 10. Kevin, do you have an announcement?
I do.
Okay. While Kevin's coming up, Jane Vivona, the director of the Bright Start Nursery School, is retiring as of the end of this month and closing her preschool. The Woods Edge Nature Preschool is coming in. I would like for us to sign a retirement card for Jane. So if you would, when you get your coffee hour, the clipboard is right back there. Just add your name to it, even if you don't know her. I would like to see a nice card full of names just to wish her well on her way in her retirement.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm here in reference to the kitchen expansion renovation committee. But I want to first mention, it's not lost when I hear Rob speak that he talks about how thankful he is for all that the church has done for him. And I'm sitting there saying, this is a complete circle because I look at how much he does for the church. So it's really a kind of neat thing. It's not lost on me. After today, getting up here speaking is a real difficult thing. It's a real challenge for me, especially after people giving their testimonies. And I don't have any real funny things. I don't have kids named after cab drivers or sisters named after hockey players or anything. But I will promise I will make reference to the Super Bowl 51. Go Pats. I'm following up on what Rob Wilkerson spoke about a couple of weeks ago. As many of you know, we're in the early stages of a kitchen renovation and an expansion plan. This idea has had its origin a few years ago, being developed collectively through the trustees, the finance committee, the ad board, and whoever else we could coerce into helping us. To date, we have plans drawn up, general contractor identified, and health department approval. We have a kitchen committee and, it's actually a lot. It's a short list, but that was a lot of work. Let's see, the kitchen committee is currently working on the building department and fire department approval. We're working on numbers and feasibility of the sprinkler system. We have a group working on how to finance and pay for this project. I'm impressed by the diligence and the enthusiasm that has been put in so far. We have a long ways to go. One of the things that I bring to the table is perspective. I have been in and around this church for about 50 years, and I've seen it grow and I've seen it shrink. I've seen an amazing amount of love and energy poured into this church. I mention this because I think that the church families, that the church, like families, have generations. Our founding families, our first generation, had a daunting task, build a Methodist church in this little suburban town chock full of Catholics, and with a strong Methodist church on the adjoining town of Reading. This must have sounded insurmountable, but they succeeded and we, the current generation, benefit profoundly from their hard work. So what does this generation do? What will families 20, 30, 40 years from now say about us? Will we be as inspirational to them as the founding families have been to us? In the process of accomplishing this kitchen project, we have and will continue to run into many challenges and roadblocks. We will overcome these. Eli the other day asked me, Dad, do you realize that the Patriots never led in Super Bowl 51 until they won the game? Just think about that. Fortunately for the Patriots, the game isn't measured halfway through. It's the final score that counts. So let's play this out. Let's be the team or generation that everyone remembers for their vision and hard work.
Schofield Youth Mission Scholarship applications. The winner of that scholarship will be announced the following week on June 11th. So there's a link in the email to scholarship applications. If you have any questions, please ask, and we hope to get lots of kiddos who would like to receive that mission scholarship. Last announcement is to remember the two-minute rule. For the first 2 minutes after church, please do not go talk to your best friend. Talk to somebody who is new to you or someone whose name you don't know, and go talk to your friend or family later. Except for me, because I'm not talking to my mom.
Talking with or talking to?
This is your everybody's name. It's okay to not know their name. I forget your name. Do that in the first 2 minutes, all right? And sign the card for Jane Verona. For celebration and thanks, I have nothing on my sheet. This church runs because of volunteers all over the place, so we like to acknowledge that. Who are we celebrating or thanking today? I'm going to go with Joe. That's not revenge, I just go with Joe. Celebrate the guys who are having a head shave. Give them a hand. Mom, you can go ahead if you want to. Celebrate.
I was going to thank Kathy McNally, who's hosting Coffee Hour for the first time.
Kathy McNally was the coffee hour. All right. With that, please stand for the benediction. May the God who empowers us with strength, with wisdom, and with gentleness be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.